Good morning. It's a good day that we can come here and worship our Lord and God and Creator. I'd like to welcome everyone here, especially like to welcome those that are visiting, and ask that you stay afterwards that we might get to know you better. If you have any question about anything we do, you certainly would be our friend to bring that up to us, and we'd be happy to study with you. Also, I'd like to welcome those that are watching via live stream. If you're here in the Tampa Bay area and are able, we certainly would encourage you to be here and to be a part of the service. At this time, we'll go to our Heavenly Father in a word of prayer. Let's pray with me. Our Heavenly Father, we humbly approach your throne in prayer and thanksgiving. We thank you for the beauty of your creation and all that you've created, the very sustenance of life that you bless us with each and every day. Our Heavenly Father, we're so blessed among this church family with the many new babies that have been born in the recent weeks or week. We thank you for that blessing and pray that you'll be with those, with the mothers and the children. Pray that you'll be with Bethany Nerlin and her child and with Sarah Trimble and her child. Pray that you'll be with the Horns as they're going through the adoption process, that everything works out well. We rejoice with the new babe that we have in Christ, with Kendall Durrell. We pray that you'll be with her and that she has a life ahead of her that's in the service of your kingdom and lives an obedient life to you. We're blessed in this church family of the many families we have with young children. We're so thankful for that and pray that you'll be with those parents and those children, that they have good Christian homes and raise their children according to your word and the precepts of the Bible. We love you, but we know that you loved us first. And you have love that our Heavenly Father that is far greater than ours in the sacrifice of your Son upon the cross at Calvary. Pray that you'll be with us as we later go through that, we partake of the memorial, thinking back to that sacrifice. We know that there are several in our congregation who suffer at this time with loss of loved ones. We pray that you'll be with the Meyer family, with Paul, with the loss of his brother, and with Ebony, with the loss of her son. We know there are those that are struggling physically that have had treatments recently that have been very successful, and we're so thankful for the good procedures and how everything has occurred for Jordan Schaus and Sue Walker. And our Heavenly Father, we thank you for that. Pray that you continue with them and it be your will that their health is fully restored. There are many that are struggling with their health still that are undergoing procedures, and ask that you be mindful of Jack Gay, Aaron Kreck, and Aaron Reynolds, who's been suffering so long. I pray that everything goes well in those procedures for him. Our Heavenly Father, we know that you keep your promises, and we can trust in you. And pray that we live lives that are obedient and follow your will and according to the footsteps of Christ. Pray that you'll be with us as we go on through this service, that everything is according to your will and pleasing to you. We thank you again for the sacrifice of your Son upon the cross of Calvary. I ask you to forgive us of our wrongs and to use us in your service and to save us in the end. I pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Scripture reading this morning will be Psalm 24, 1 through 5. The earth and everything in it, the world and its inhabitants belong to the Lord, for he laid its foundation on the seas and established it on the rivers. Who may ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? The one who has clean hands and a pure heart, who has not appealed to what is false and who has not sworn deceitfully. He will receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation.
Praise the Lord and shine bright for His own. I'm going to ask you to take your Bible and open to Galatians chapter 6. Galatians chapter 6, we'll begin by reading there this morning. Galatians chapter 6. If you are unfamiliar with our church family, if you're visiting with us and have not before, this is the time that we reserve every single week to remember and celebrate, commemorate the death of Jesus and what his sacrifice means to us. In Galatians chapter 6 and verse 14, the Bible says, "But may it never be that I would boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, through which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world." Last summer, I had the opportunity to travel overseas to the Czech Republic to preach the gospel. And that was a wonderful opportunity. I was grateful for the chance to do that. And I was grateful to have been helped on my way by the elders here. And so, in a way, a very real way, I was supported in going there by you. And I'm thankful for that. And while I was excited and grateful for that opportunity, I was also really nervous. For starters, I was going by myself to another country that I did not speak the language. And that was really intimidating. I always wondered how I was going to get through the airport when all the signs were in a language I didn't know. I made my way through. But worse than that was the thought of having to fly in an airplane over an ocean at night. And that was really, really not cool. And while that was the thing I was most terrified of, coming in a close second place was the fear of entering another country, going through customs, and wondering whether or not something would go wrong, and they wouldn't let me in. What if I got to the gate, and the person there wouldn't let me in? What if they didn't believe me when I told them I was coming for business and not pleasure? Mostly, I was worried, what would happen if I lost my passport? What would happen if somebody stole my passport and I could not get through the gate? Which is highly likely when you're in Europe. What if they took my passport and for some reason I couldn't get in and I couldn't get home? And so for that reason, I stowed that passport away in a safe place. I secured it tightly and I checked it all the time because it was everything to me. It was my ticket in and it was my ticket out. And if I lost it, then there was nothing I could really do, right? If I lost my passport, it's not like I could pull out a wad of cash and say, hey, I'm going to pay my way in because I don't have a passport. I don't have the right papers. It's not like I could sign some document promising them that I was who I said I was. And it's not like I could do some good deed that once completed would get me into the country. At the end of the day, the passport was my only way in, and it was my only way out. Do you see where I'm going with that? I wonder, brothers and sisters, what would happen if the world ended today? What would happen if today, right at this moment, the sky was ripped open and the judgment day was here? And in this moment, you stood before God and he decided to ask you this question: why should I let you in? Why should I let you in? How would you answer that question? How would you make your case before God? What passport would you hand him? There are some people that I believe would say, Lord, you should let me in because in my life, I was really, really, really obedient. I didn't do everything perfect, but man, I was like in the 99th percentile of being obedient to you. That is what some people think, and that is how some people live. That's what they stake their hope on. They think God will let them into heaven because at the end of the day, they lived a really clean life. We see an example of that in Luke chapter 7, in verse 39, when Jesus is having dinner at Simon the Pharisee's house. The Bible says, "Now when the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, 'If this man were a prophet, he would know who and what sort of person this woman is who is touching him, that she is a sinner.'" And so when the woman from the city came in and she encountered Jesus, and Jesus didn't reject her, the Pharisee makes a quick calculation in his mind. He says, "Look, if this guy really were God, if he really were a prophet, then he would know that she had a dirty life. And for that reason, he would reject her." Because that's what he thinks. God accepts the people who live clean lives, and he rejects the people who have a dirty past. We see that attitude on display again in another parable in Luke 18. Luke 18 and verse 9, the Bible says, "And he also told this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and viewed others with contempt." And he goes on to tell the parable of the Pharisee and the publican, where the Pharisee says this: "The Pharisee stood and was praying to himself, 'God, I thank you that I am not like other people, swindlers, unjust, adulterers, or even like this tax collector.'" And so that is the way that some in the first century and some today look at themselves. That is the way, that's the thing that they do. They trust in themselves that they are righteous. And they think, "That's why God will let me in, because my life has been really clean. I purified myself. I sanctified myself. I sacrificed. I wasn't like those other people." And don't get me wrong this morning. God wants you to have a clean life. He wants you to sanctify yourself. He wants you to sacrifice for the sake of righteousness. But understand, that's not going to get you into heaven. That is not the basis on which God will let you in. There are other people who would look at God and they would say, "Look, God, you should let me in, not because my life was really clean or because I was really obedient, but because at the end of the day, I did a lot of good deeds. I loved people. I did so many good things with my life while I lived here on earth." And that is how some people think. They stake their hope on the good deeds that they've done. And they believe that because they've devoted their lives to serving others, or accomplishing an abundance of good deeds, that that is going to gain them entry into heaven. Jesus speaks to those kinds of people in this famous passage in Matthew chapter 7 in verse 21, where he says, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven will enter. Many will say to me on that day, 'Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and in your name perform many miracles?' And then I will declare to them, 'I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness.'" Now understand me. It is true that good deeds and acts of service toward others are something that God expects from us. And Matthew chapter 25 tells us that it's one thing, one basis, one factor that God will use to judge us on that day. Matthew 25, verse 34, "Then the king will say to those on his right, 'Come, you who are blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. Naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me.'" On the judgment day, God is going to think about the good deeds that you've done. That's true. Paul mentions that in the book of Titus as well, in Titus chapter 3 and verses 1 through 2. Remind them to be subject to rulers, to authorities, to be obedient, to be ready for every good deed, to malign no one, to be peaceable, gentle, showing consideration for all men. And so understand that God does expect good deeds from us. But if good deeds are all you've got, then at the end of the day, you've got nothing. You can't get into heaven just writing on a long list of good deeds. So if God asked you, "Why should I let you in?" what would you say? And all of that brings me back to the words of Paul in Galatians 6 and verse 14, where he says, "But may it never be that I would boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, through which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world." Paul knows that even though his life has been relatively clean compared to other people, it's not clean enough. He can't obey his way into heaven, not after the misdeeds and the transgressions that he's done. He knows that even though he's spent his entire life spreading the gospel to the point where he refers to himself as being poured out as a drink offering, he has poured himself out so entirely to spread the gospel after his conversion, he still knows that he can't good deed his way into heaven. And so he declares at the end of Galatians that there is one thing that he is proud of. There is one thing that he will stand on. There is one thing that gives him confidence. There is one thing that he will boast about, and that is the cross of Jesus Christ. Understand, brothers and sisters, that when you stand before God on the day of judgment, and if he were to ask you that question, why should I let you in? There's only one right answer. And that answer is Jesus. That answer is always Jesus. That answer is only Jesus. The answer is, you should let me in because I found your grace beneath the blood-stained cross of your Son. That is the only reason any of us are going to enter heaven. And so what we do now this morning is we partake in a supper that helps us remember that our salvation, our hope, our eternity is based on nothing. It's founded on nothing but the death and the sacrifice of our precious Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And so now at this time, let us boast in his cross. Let us pray. Dear Lord our God, we thank you so much for Jesus. Please let us recognize, please help us to remember that while we may do good things, and while we may be obedient, while we may be in the middle of sanctifying ourselves, that we do not deserve to spend eternity with you. That ultimately we are not people who have earned a place in heaven, but we are an assembly of the saved. We are an assembly of the rescued. Thank you so much for Jesus and his life. Thank you for his sacrifice. In his name we pray. Amen.
Let's pray for the cup. Dear Lord our God, please help us see his death. Please help us see his death every day to realize what he endured, what he sacrificed for our sake. Please help us to never forget what was done to save us, that your Son Jesus died a horrific death on the cross in order to redeem us from our sins. Thank you so much for the gift of his life. Thank you so much for being willing to send your Son, your only begotten Son, to adopt us as your children. In his name we pray and we give you thanks. Amen. I hope that none of us would ever fall under the delusion that our entry into heaven is based on our good works or a good showing in the flesh, because that would require perfection. In order to deserve heaven, you have to live a perfect life, and none of us will attain that. Our hope is founded on Jesus and his cross. And I believe that if you keep your mind trained on that, that it will change your life in the coming week. When you learn to do what Paul did and boast only in the cross, it should change your life in a number of different ways. But one way that I hope it will change your life as we reflect, as we think about his sacrifice today, one way that I hope it will change your life is by offering you real, real assurance. Because sometimes we fail, and sometimes we feel far from God. Sometimes we have that deep sense of hopelessness, like we aren't enough and we never will be enough. And I want you to realize that those feelings and those thoughts, they're born of a heart that is forgotten to boast only in the cross. You are not and never will be good enough to go to heaven. But your salvation is not based on how good you are. Your salvation is based on the perfect life of Jesus. Because you have been washed in his blood through the waters of baptism, because you confess your sins and repent of them when you commit them, the question is no longer, how good are you? But the question is now, how good was he? That's what it means to boast in the cross. Brothers and sisters, Christians are not usually boastful people, nor should we be. But I pray that as you reflect on the death of Jesus this week, that you will learn how to truly boast in his cross. The Lord's Supper is now concluded. At this time, as a matter of convenience, we also want to mention that every week this church family is commanded to take up a collection. We do a lot of good work here, and it is our mission and our goal to do the work that God has given us as his church. We take care of the needs of our brothers and sisters in Christ, and we do everything we can to spread his gospel to every corner of the globe. And right now, as we take up this collection, that's what that money is for. I want you to know that if you're a visitor, we are not asking for your money. This is not a solicitation of you, but rather this is a requirement of this church family here that we would lay by some of the funds that we have prospered so that we may continue the Lord's work here in this place. And so at this time, let us pray. Oh, let me mention, if you're unaware, you can use the Givify app. You can also use the baskets at all of the exits if you would like to give this morning. Let's pray for the collection. Dear Lord, our God, we thank you so much for all that you've given us, mostly for Jesus, so much for Jesus. But also we need to recognize just how many things we've been blessed with in this life. To have the things that we have and live in the place that we do is extraordinary. And we pray that we would not let our luxury and our opulence blind us from the fact that we are merely stewards of what belongs to you. Please let us use our blessings in a way that glorifies you and furthers your work. Please be with us. Help us to give with cheerful and generous hearts this morning. In your son's name we pray. Amen.
Because he lives. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 34 at the end of the chapter says, when the perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come the fastest saying which is written, death, where is your victory? Well, death, where is your victory, and Hades thy sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of the sin is law. But thanks be to God, who gives us victory through Christ our Lord. Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the works of the Lord, knowing that the Lord of your labor is not in vain. I ask again if you would please join me in standing as we sing this.
Thank you. morning, good morning. Good to see everybody today. If you have a Bible today, I'll ask you to open. Need to go to the book of Titus, second division of that little book written by Paul to his young friend and evangelist. And we'll ask you to be ready to read there. There's one statement that is there that will capture our attention this morning in the book of Titus chapter 2. And while you're opening there, we welcome all of you. Thanks so much for being here today. We are blessed today as we have been in the last several of our assemblies and really as we always are with a host of visitors. Many are still visiting with us from around the country because you were involved in events down the street this past week. We're glad you're with us today to share worship with us. And we hope that your time will be profitably spent with us. We remind you that we have classes this afternoon at 5 o'clock for everyone, and we hope that you can be with us then. If you're visiting with us this morning, I'm going to ask you, if you will, to indulge me for just 1 minute, if you will, because I need to do just a little bit of housekeeping this morning. And so if you're visiting, please indulge me for just a second, but a couple of things that I need to bring to the attention of our church family. First, foremost, we just want to say that after Wednesday evening service, we had such a wonderful singing Wednesday night. What a tremendous thing that was to have our building not only full, but, you know, chairs everywhere. We had well over 800 people in our building Wednesday night, but the numbers really don't matter. We've never put any emphasis in this church on numbers. The worship that was offered to God, the singing that was done, the praise that was given to God, and the encouragement to each other, that's what matters. And thank you for sharing that with us. But after that assembly Wednesday night, we're so happy to tell you that Kendall Durrell was baptized, and we are so happy for her and so proud of her. Just such a wonderful young lady. We have so many tremendous young people in our church family that are such a blessing. Kendall, we're so, so proud of you. I want to mention to you this morning, Kathy Parks reached out to me, and beginning on Thursday, her mom Sadie, of course, Sadie celebrated her 94th, 95th birthday just a few weeks ago. On Thursday of this week, Sadie began failing. And as so often is the case, you just don't know when that occurs, whether that's just kind of a temporary bump in the road or whether or not she's going to actually continue to fail. Kathy reached out to me this morning and just said that she'd like for us to pray for her mom, that she's at a point where she would like for us to pray that very quickly and peacefully she can exit this life. Sadie is not going to be better. She's going to leave this world. And Kathy has asked in particular that we pray that prayer for her mom. And we're going to do that in just a minute. But we're also going to pray for something that I'm sure you have mentioned privately in your prayers. But we need to pray, ladies and gentlemen, for the fact that in a catastrophe just beyond imagination, at this point, 28,000 people have died in Turkey and Syria. I heard on the news this morning that it's estimated that number may in fact double. Stop and think about that. And so that means that there are hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of family members who are grieving and hurting today. And in countries where, quite honestly, they don't have the infrastructure and the resources that we would have in America to respond to that kind of a circumstance and tragedy. And so those people, we need to pray for them as well. So before we get where we're going this morning, I'm going to ask you just to bow your heads and let's just pray together about these things. Our good Father, we pray to you today in the name of Jesus Christ, believing that you hear us, but not only that you hear us, but that you have the ability and the will to intervene in ways of which our minds cannot conceive to make a difference for good. And so we rejoice, Father. We rejoice with the baptism of Kendall on Wednesday night. We pray for her life in the kingdom, her life in your Son. We are grateful for her and for all of the young people who are part of our church family. We pray, Father, for those who this morning are struggling and grieving because of grief. And we pray, Father, for Sadie. Sadie who's been a part of our lives in this church family for so very, very long. And longer than that, her daughter, Kathy. And we pray, Holy God, that you would allow Sadie to quickly and peacefully exit this world to one that is far better. We pray, Father, for those who have been devastated by earthquakes, not only for the thousands upon thousands who have lost their lives, but the multiple thousands beyond that who in their families grieve for them. And beyond that, the hundreds and hundreds of thousands who are displaced from their home. We can't even begin to imagine what that would be like. But we know that you see and we know that you care. And we pray that these United States and other nations who are able to be of help will do just that. We're thankful for the resources you've given us in this land that allow us not only to care for ourselves, but to be a benefit to humanity. And we pray that we will. And we pray, Father, you'll hear our prayer today. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, we talk about those things and those things that we see that are catastrophic, that make watching the news a very difficult thing. We also, of course, need to be reminded that there is so much that is so good. And so in Guthrie, in his prayer this morning, we've mentioned in emails, and we just want to mention before we begin this morning, you know, we've also, on the other side of that, we've had new babies come into our family this week. And so the Horns, you know, are out in Arizona. They're receiving a baby that they're adopting. And I have a name for you for him. His name is Tatum Oakley. And we pray that that continue, that process will go just smoothly as it can be. The Trimbles, of course, have their first baby. And that's Theodore Franklin. Theodore Franklin Trimble. Sounds like a law firm, doesn't it? What a great little boy. And we're so happy for them. And then the Nerlands have a baby. The Nerlands. By the way, that's Tyler and Bethany, not Doug and Brenda. Now that would be an announcement. But Tyler and Bethany have George Tyler. And we're so happy. We're so happy for them. So, as we often quote, though much is taken, Tennyson said, much abides, and it does. Thank you for giving me a couple of minutes to talk about things that for our church family are important. In gospel meetings around the country and from this pulpit from time to time, I introduce a sermon with an illustration, and the contents of the illustration changes each time, but the illustration many of you will recognize. And the illustration simply is that I have some really great news this morning. I have some great news this morning because this past week, in fact, I received a revelation from God. And in fact, God asked me specifically to inform you this morning that God has evolved in some of his thinking, and he would like, as of today, for you to update your Bibles. And so if you got your Bible this morning, you need to take a pen because there are going to be some words that God wants you to cross out, and there's some other words that God wants you to write in. So this is an amazing thing. We're going to get Bible version 2.0 today. What a great thing that God is doing, that he gave me this revelation. And so your Bible says, for example, in Exodus 20 and 14, that you should not commit adultery. And God said, look, Don, I want you to tell them that I want to clarify that just a little bit. And God said, I want you to write down your Bible. Now, you should not commit adultery unless you are disappointed in your marriage or the chemistry between you and your potential partner is so strong that you can't resist. And Don, you tell them, remember, above all else, I want you to be happy. Well, that's going to make a lot of folks happy right there, I'll tell you. And God said, listen, Don, I want you to talk to them a little bit about Leviticus 20 and 13, where it said, if a man lies with a male as he lies with a woman, both of them have committed an abomination. And God said, Don, I want you to tell them to strike the last four words. Just go ahead and mark that out of your Bible. We're going to take those last four words out of your Bible. And God said, let's amend that to this. Both of them have an innate desire that I created within them, and it is permanently fixed. And remember, I just want you to be happy. Well, that's going to make a lot of folks happy, isn't it? And then God said, in Galatians 5 and 4, 2,000 years ago it was written, you have become estranged from Christ, you have fallen from grace. Now, there's a context there, of course, where they were going back and seeking to be justified by the old law. And God said, well, when you do that, you become estranged from Christ and you have fallen from grace. And God said, Don, I want you to tell them to amend that to, you are not estranged from Christ. You have not fallen from grace because when you sin, my virtue, my righteousness is placed on you, and I see you through the perfect righteousness of Jesus Christ. And then finally, God said, one more verse, Don, to tell them. This is Matthew 19 and 9. I say to you that whoever divorces his wife, except for sexual immorality, and marries another, commits adultery. And God said, you know, I've given that a little bit of thought. And so tell them, I want them to write in their Bibles this. I say to you that whoever divorces his wife, except for sexual immorality, and good news, you get to define sexual immorality based on your time and culture, and then marries another, commits adultery. Well, there's the updates to your Bible. Maybe we'll get more next week. Who knows? Now, you know and I want to make this abundantly clear, that what I have just said to you is absolutely absurd, and God did not talk to me, and God did not tell me to say those things, and I want to say that clearly so it doesn't end up on Facebook tomorrow. So I don't know if I can make that any clearer, and if anybody goes another direction with that, that's on you. You know and I know that what I have just said is patently absurd. Those are lies. Now, those are lies that are told in the name of God, but they are lies. They are told as truth. They are accepted as truth. They are liked on Facebook as truth. But the reality is, again, they are nothing more than lies. And somebody says, well, Don, who on earth would ever say anything like that in religion? Well, the first two of those things denominations have been saying for a long time. The last two of those things are said by some folks that would probably surprise you. Now, there are a lot of reasons for this pollution of God's word, not the least of which is a minimizing of the importance of sound doctrine. Titus 2 and beginning to verse 1, we're asked you to open your Bible, where Paul enjoins his young friend and he says, look, you've got to teach them to speak things that become sound doctrine, healthy doctrine, doctrine that when you believe it and embrace it and live it, it will make you spiritually healthy and strong. But I know, ladies and gentlemen, the word doctrine is a word that a lot of folks don't really care much for. Yeah, I understand that. A lot of folks say things like, look, Don, the Bible is a love letter from God, and we need to emphasize that, not the rules that God put in place. Well, you know what? The Bible is a love letter from God. There is no doubt about that. It is one of the most amazing pieces of writing that expresses love from one heart to another that you'll ever find. It is a story of God's amazing, unfathomable love and grace. But we also need to remember, for example, those of us who are moms and dads, that we put rules in place for our kids, not because we hated them, not because we were trying to inhibit them. We put rules in place for them because we love them, because we wanted them to have the safest and best life possible. And somebody says, you know, Don, the problem is that rules divide, love unites. Well, harmony is certainly the will of God. There is no doubt about that. In fact, Paul said, look, now I plead with you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all speak the same thing. He wanted there to be harmony, that there be no divisions among you. Be joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. But clearly, ladies and gentlemen, harmony in that verse is based on some kind of a standard. I mean, if you're going to speak the same thing and have the same mind and same judgment, there's got to be some standard upon which you operate so that you can have the same mind and the same judgment, and you can speak the same thing. In many quarters today, doctrine, and the synonym for doctrine in the New Testament is the word teaching, so we'll use those two words interchangeably this morning because that's the way the New Testament does. In many quarters, teaching and doctrine have been replaced, of course, with feelings. How we feel about something has become really the most important thing in many quarters. But there's a challenge with that. Now, feelings are love. People love feelings much more than teaching and doctrine because feelings don't challenge you. Feelings don't force you to alter your thinking, your behavior. You just feel. You just have an experience, an emotion. And feelings really have no boundaries. There's no line of right or wrong, appropriate or inappropriate in regard to feelings or emotions or experience. Again, you just feel. And then thirdly, they are so loved because thirdly, feelings validate. Feelings validate that it is, if I feel good about this, then I will take that as a sign from God, an indication from God that I must be right. And so in so many quarters, even among our brethren, sadly to say, teaching or doctrine is being replaced with how I feel about something, what my emotions are about that, what my experience is. It's why there's so many who approach the Bible as though it's kind of a piece of artwork in a gallery or a piece of classical music where you just interpret it according to your own individual experience or desire. Now, I want to say something to you, ladies and gentlemen. That is a far cry. That is a far, far cry from what we talked about last week out of the book of 2 John and then in some passages in the book of 1 John. And you remember last week we talked about the fact that John balances truth and love. But in 1 John in particular, in 1 John 2, beginning to verse 3, listen to what he said. By this we know that we know him. That's a pretty strong statement, isn't it? By this we know that we know him if we keep his commandments. Whoever keeps his word, truly the love of God is perfected in him. And he said it again. In case we missed it, he said it again. By this we know that we are in him. By this we know that we are in him. You have a Bible? I want you to go to the end of your New Testament, the very last chapter of your New Testament, which is Revelation chapter 22. And so I just want you to open to Revelation 22 with me for just a second. And there are a couple of verses here that I think will be relevant to what we're talking about. In Revelation 22, when John is concluding the Revelation, and really the capstone of the Bible, Jesus is kind of concluding the capstone of the New Testament, the capstone of the Bible. What does he say at the end? I mean, you would imagine that whatever he's going to say at the end, this is important. These are last words. Last words are always important. And Jonathan made the observation a moment ago that good deeds and obedience will not earn your way into heaven. But ladies and gentlemen, let's be really, 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 really clear about something else. A lack of good deeds and obedience can certainly keep you out of heaven. And we should not ignore that. And so in Revelation 22 and beginning in verse 12, Jesus said, "Behold, I am coming quickly, and my reward is with me." Look at this. "To give everyone according to his work." And so clearly this matters to God, what we do in service of God. And in verse 14, "Blessed are those who do his commandments." Well, why? Because they have a right to the tree of life, and secondly, they can enter the gates into the city. And so if we want to know how we gain admission into the city of God, into heaven, Jesus says very, very clearly, "Blessed are those who obey my will, who understand what sound doctrine is and determine that they are going to keep that and observe that." And without that foundation, ladies and gentlemen, that Jesus is Lord, not just your buddy and not just your pal, but Lord, without that foundation, the foundation of authority that is based on the Bible, then teaching really becomes little more than cotton candy. Now, cotton candy tastes really good. They sell it at ball games, and it tastes good. And it's the easiest thing you'll ever eat because you don't have to chew. You just put it in your mouth, and it melts away, and it's sweet. But cotton candy doesn't have any substance. There's nothing nourishing in it, and you can't live on it. In teaching, ladies and gentlemen, that divorces itself from sound doctrine, sound teaching, is like cotton candy. It sounds good, tastes good, makes you feel good, as we said a moment ago, but it doesn't have any substance to it. We can do better than that. At the very beginning of the New Testament church, in Acts 2 and beginning of verse 22, we have this statement. "That these brethren continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, the breaking of bread and prayers." The apostles' doctrine. Now, we said a moment ago that the word doctrine and teaching are used interchangeably, and so that is from the New King James Bible that I typically read from. But the English Standard Version that I also love says, "They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, the breaking of bread and prayers." It's interesting that in Acts 2 and verse 42, what you have are newborn baby Christians. I mean, they are still wet from the baptistry. I mean, they are just learning to walk as a newborn baby Christian, and yet they understood that two things were indispensable to spiritual life. The first was believing. The first was believing. Doctrine that came from the apostles, which came from Jesus Christ, they understood that believing was indispensable. And secondly was belonging, relationships, fellowship, both in the collective worship and in their individual lives. And so these baby Christians who really didn't understand very much at this point in time, they understood that believing and belonging were critically important. And that believing part of that is mentioned first. And it's given oftentimes in the New Testament primacy. I just want you to think, well, look at the screen with me for just a second here. And I just want you to notice, if you will, how this is kind of an unbroken thread through the New Testament. That this matter of doctrine and teaching matters to God. And so that was Acts 2 and 42. Just three chapters later in Acts 5, the apostles are called before the council. The council said, "Didn't we strictly command you not to teach in this name? And behold, look, you have filled Jerusalem with your doctrine. You have filled Jerusalem with your teaching." Because this is what they were about. Romans 6 and beginning in verse 17. God be thanked that though you were the slaves of sin, yet you obeyed from the heart the form of doctrine to which you were delivered. That is, there was a standard of teaching which they obeyed and to which they were absolutely committed. 1 Timothy 4 and beginning in verse 13. Until I come, give attention to reading, to exhortation, and to doctrine. When Paul wrote to Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 4, familiar language, he said, Timothy, you got to preach the word. You got to do that when it's easy and when it's not easy. You got to reprove, rebuke, and exhort, encourage with great patience and instruction, because the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but wanting to have their ears itch, that is to eat cotton candy, rather than doctrine, they'd like cotton candy, they will accumulate for themselves teachers in accordance to their own desires. And then to Timothy as well, in 1 Timothy chapter 6, if anyone advocates a different doctrine and does not agree with sound words, those of our Lord Jesus Christ, with a doctrine conforming to godliness, to be, he is conceited and really understands nothing. And so there's a healthy doctrine in teaching that makes us stronger. And it's why, for example, the Hebrew writer ended his book by saying, do not be led away by diverse and strange teachings. Now, you're a wise audience. One thing I know every Sunday when I stand in front of this group, I'm talking to people who know the Bible and who appreciate and love the Bible. You cannot see the emphasis that goes through the New Testament about sound teaching and sound doctrine and then listen to the Hebrew writer say, look, don't be led away by divisive and strange teachings. You know when you put those two together that the Hebrew writer is saying, folks, you're going to try to do that. We saw last week that when Paul gathered the elders of Ephesus on that little island of Miletus, he warned them and he said, look, from among your own selves. And if we were to broaden that, we'd say, even among Christians, men will speak perverse things to draw away disciples after themselves. Why talk about these things? I mean, this is the third lesson, and it's the final lesson, if you're wondering. But this is the third lesson in this arc about the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but... Why are we even concerned about this? We're concerned about it because too many people are not concerned about it. Because we've heard too many individuals kind of in a condescending way say, look, I got to tell you, Don, I just don't get really hung up on doctrine. I really don't get too hung up on doctrine anymore. But can I say to you, ladies and gentlemen, that the doctrine is unimportant is a doctrine unto itself. We all believe something, and it's a dangerous doctrine. So I'm going to share with you three things quickly, and the lesson's yours. Here they are. Number one, doctrine and fellowship with God are inseparable. Doctrine and fellowship with God are absolutely inseparable. You know how I know that? From a verse that we looked at last Sunday in 2 John, beginning in verse 9, when John said, whoever transgresses and does not abide in the doctrine of Christ does not have God. He who abides in the doctrine of Christ has both the Father and the Son. Now, you may have a translation this morning that doesn't use the word transgresses. That's kind of an old Bible word. You may have a translation that says, goes on ahead. Whoever goes on ahead and does not abide in the doctrine of Christ does not have God. He that abides in the doctrine of Christ, he has both the Father and the Son. If I don't learn anything else from that verse, I learn that the doctrine of Christ and fellowship with God are absolutely inseparable. So I would ask you this morning, does that verse sound like healthy doctrine is optional equipment in the Christian's life or in the church's life? Well, when would anybody ever do that? When would anybody ever go on ahead or transgress and not abide in the doctrine of Christ? Well, it happens when you add something to what God has clearly said. It happens when mere men decide that they can introduce some new teaching and put that on a par with the Word of God. And it happens all the time, in spite of the fact that Peter said, look, God's divine power is granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness. Now, we got to decide if we believe that or not. Do we believe Peter when he said, look, God has given us every single thing that we need for life and godliness? Do we believe that or not? I want to just put this on your screen. This is not in your family report, but spiritual maturity is not measured by new revelation or new understanding. Spiritual maturity is not measured by new revelation or new understanding. No, it's measured by the knowledge of and relationship with Jesus Christ. That's what John said. Whoever transgresses and goes on ahead of the doctrine of Christ, he doesn't have God. And so anybody who says, you know, I've got new information, I've got special insight that God has given me, John says you probably ought to run from them. Because John says in 1 John and 2 John, he says it very clearly. John says, look, we have given you the light, the person, and the teaching of Jesus Christ. And anyone who says, look, we got to have some new understanding about this. Anyone who says we got to be more progressive, we got to update Jesus' truth for a more modern world. Anyone who does that, John says he is Antichrist. Not just that he's against Christ, but he has replaced Christ. He's created his own Jesus. Or someone who says, look, we have uncovered some special information that really has kind of been hidden all these years. You hear that when individuals take some foundational biblical truth that good brethren, wise brethren, knowledgeable brethren have pretty well agreed on through time. And now we have someone saying, you know what, I used to see that passage that way, but now I understand that. And they're going a completely different direction. I mean, ladies and gentlemen, are we really to believe that God said, you know what I'm going to do? Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to give them a word that for 2,000 years, they're really not going to understand. But then I'm going to send some predominantly young guys, and they're going to explain what nobody else got for 2,000 years. I'm sorry. You know, we've said many times from this pulpit that this is a Bible church. We still believe in establishing Bible authority. We still intend to function according to a thus saith the Lord. Ladies and gentlemen, we've all got to be content with what the Bible says. I know that many are not. So many want to push the limits. They want to dwell in controversy. They want to spend more time thinking about what the Bible doesn't say rather than what it does. For some individuals, thinking outside the box has become their consuming passion. The problem is that often they don't know what's in the box. Or as one preacher said on a podcast not long ago, you know what, I'm standing out here in left field. Maybe in 10 years you'll be standing out here in left field with me. Well, I hope not. I hope where I'll be standing is firmly rooted in the Word of God. Here's the bottom line. Whoever goes onward and abides not in the doctrine of Christ does not have God. And we've got to understand that when you go ahead of God's doctrine, you leave God behind, because God will not make that trip with you. He won't go there with you. Doctrine and fellowship with God are inseparable. Secondly, doctrine, the doctrine of Christ and walking by faith are inseparable. The doctrine of Christ and walking by faith are inseparable. And here's the passage, you know, that that we would quote along that line. Paul said, 2 Corinthians 5, beginning in verse 7, that we walk by faith and not by sight. We walk by faith and not by sight. And so somebody says, look, Don, you know, here's the deal, Don. You say that you look to Scripture to find what to believe and what to practice. But the problem is, Don, that you're walking by sight. You're not walking by faith. And we're supposed to walk by faith, not by sight. You're walking by sight because you keep going back to the Bible. Well, let's just assume that statement is true. I mean, for the sake of argument this morning, let's just assume that statement is true. I'm not saying that it's true, so don't put that on Facebook tomorrow. I'm saying let's just assume this morning that that statement were true. What would we do with that? So I set my Bible aside. So you say, okay, I can't. I'm walking by sight, so I'm gonna set my Bible aside. So we got it aside. Now I'm gonna walk by faith. Now walking by faith is important, isn't it? Because the Hebrew writer said that without faith it is impossible to please God. He that comes to God must believe that he is, and that's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. And so, without faith, it is absolutely impossible to please God. So I've got to walk by faith. There is no doubt about that. That is crystal clear. So, here's my question. What am I supposed to have, or who am I supposed to have faith in? Because I got to walk by faith. It's imperative. So, who or what am I to have faith in? And somebody says, well, you need to have faith in Jesus. Okay, I'm with you there. How do I know what I'm supposed to believe about Jesus? Well, you're going to have to read your Bible. Nope, can't do that. Can't read my Bible because that would be walking by sight. And somebody says, well, then you need to listen. I tell you what, listen to a podcast of your favorite preacher. Okay, all right, I'll do that. Well, how do I know that what that preacher is telling me is truth? Well, you got to compare it with the Bible. Well, yes, I mean, we're back to that, aren't we? Because that's the way it is. We walk by faith and not by sight, but what's that familiar verse say? Faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. At some point, you've got to get back to the word of God. Living by the word of God is, in fact, living by faith. It is tragic that so many have brought this foolish reasoning. They end up diminishing the Bible that they claim to cherish. There's a verse that in the last 12 months we've put on this screen several times. And I'm going to put it up here again this morning, because I think it is so critically important. It's Romans 6 and beginning in verse 17, where Paul said, but thanks be to God that though you were slaves of sin, you became obedient from the heart to the form of teaching to which you were committed. And I put this on the screen, I don't know how many times in the last 12 months, and every time I do, I say, you know what, you're gonna see it again, because it's such a critically important verse. I wanna ask you this morning, what do you get out of that verse? When you read that verse, what do you get out of that verse? What I get out of that verse is that being free from sin and right with God involves at least four constituent elements. Being free from sin and right from God with God is not, it is not the Calvinistic idea that somehow God is going to irresistibly move on me and he's going to cover me with his righteousness regardless of what I do, and I'm okay and you're okay. If I understand this verse correctly, being free from sin and right with God involves four constituent elements. Number one, these individuals were obedient. They listened, they believed, they obeyed. Not just the easy stuff, not just what individuals might think is the big stuff. They obeyed everything to be pleasing to God. Secondly, they did that from the heart. They did it from the heart, not superficially, not occasionally, but from the heart. They obeyed with an understanding that there is a God and they are not him. And I will tell you, ladies and gentlemen, that when individuals obey from the heart, it will correct behavioral issues that need to fall in line with God. And thirdly, they obeyed from the heart that form of teaching that was delivered to them. And so they obeyed from the heart doctrine or teaching. There's so many that want to believe that there really are no rules in the New Testament that are applicable today. That again, the New Testament is just a love letter. It's not a perfect law of liberty, as James calls it. Well, it is an amazing love letter. But these people did not turn to God so that they could just do their own thing, or they didn't manufacture their own brand of religion. They obeyed from the heart the form of teaching that Paul had delivered to them. And so Paul would say things like this. He taught righteous living. He taught laying aside the old man and putting on a new man that is made in the image of Jesus. He taught one Lord and one faith and one body and one baptism. Paul taught that believers should be of one mind and one voice. He taught that if others live differently or disobediently, that they should have discipline exercised on their behalf to help bring them back to God. He taught forgiveness based on the grace of God and the love of God and the cross of Jesus Christ. And this is the form of teaching that they obeyed. And not only that, but they were committed to that. They were committed to that teaching. They didn't outgrow it. They didn't abandon it. They didn't feel like we reached a point where God's truth is no longer applicable or applicational. They were committed to that. They studied it, believed it. They followed it. They taught it. They were committed to a truth that does not change. Because the doctrine of Christ and walking by faith, and faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God, are inseparable. And finally, the doctrine of Christ and judgment are inseparable. And nobody wants to talk about that. And I understand that. I understand that in 21st century America, nobody wants to talk about accountability. Nobody wants to talk about final judgment. In fact, in American culture, about the only verse that anybody knows about judgment is Matthew 7 and 1, where Jesus said, judge not that you be not judged. And folks can quote that all day long. And they're completely oblivious, of course, to John 7 and 34, where Jesus said, look, don't judge according to appearance, but I do want you to judge with righteous judgment. Take a look at the screen with me one more time, if you will. This is a reading out of John chapter 12. Listen to what he said. Jesus said, if anyone hears my voice and does not believe, I do not judge him. I didn't come to the world to judge the world, but to save the world. He rejects me and does not receive my word. He has one that judges him. The word that I have spoken, look at that. The word that I have spoken will judge a man in the last day, because I have not spoken on my own authority. But the Father who sent me gave me a commandment, what I should say and what I should speak. And I know that his commandment is everlasting life. Now, I got to tell you, you've got to work hard to get around that verse. Jesus just said, look, the doctrine of Christ and final judgment are inseparable. That's the standard. Not my feelings or your feelings, but one simple standard. It's why in Revelation 20, beginning of verse 12, John said, I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened. I take that to be the Old Covenant and the New Covenant, because there were people standing before God. Some lived under the old law, some under the new. It's saying you're going to be judged according to whatever covenant you live by. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. And look at this. The dead were judged according to their works by the things that were written in the books. Now, we can try to minimize the value of obeying God and keeping his commandments and those works. As we said a moment ago, you can't work your way into heaven. You can never put God in your debt. But a lack of those things can certainly keep you out of heaven. And so the question is your soul ready for the judgment that's going to occur by Jesus Christ? I want to end this morning with a simple statement that I've ended with many times. For years, in our fellowship in Churches of Christ, we've asked the question in song, what will you do with Jesus? It's an old, old hymn. What will you do with Jesus? I've got a sermon that I've preached in gospel meetings where I asked that question, and the sermon is about the fact that I think there are only four answers to that question. Now, maybe I've missed one somewhere, and if so, point it out to me, and I'll amend the sermon, but I think that there are only four answers to that question. What will you do with Jesus? One answer is that you can reject him and not do what he says. God will always give you that choice. God will not reach down from heaven and force anybody to obey him. He just will not do that. God will give you that choice. You can reject him as Lord and not do what he says. Secondly, you can reject him as Lord, but do what he says. And you say, who would ever do that? Well, you probably know people like that. I mean, we all know people, don't we? They're good people. They live a good life. They raise a good family. They make really good neighbors. But they're not Christians, and they don't ever intend to become Christians. They're good people, but they really don't ever intend to be obedient to Jesus in other ways. Or third, you can confess him as Lord, but not do what he says. And there are a lot of folks that do that. In fact, Jesus said, Luke 6:46, why do you call me Lord? Why do you say I'm your Lord and do not the things that I command? I mean, in 21st century, we might, if we were going to use illustrations of that, we might say, a man or a woman might say, why do you call me your doctor if you're not going to come and see me when you're sick? And if you do, you refuse to do what I prescribe for you so you can be better. Why call me your doctor? Or maybe more applicable to this side of the room, a professor might say, why do you call me your professor? You don't come to class. And you don't do the assignments. You don't do your homework. You don't do what I ask you to do. So why do you call me your professor? And Jesus said, why do you call me Lord? I mean, that word means something if you're not going to do what I say. Or fourth, you can confess him as Lord and do what he says. And that's the fourth choice. Jesus says, come to me, all of you who are laboring and you are wearied under the burden of sin. You're sick and tired of that spiritually. And he says, I'll give you rest. But we have to come on his terms because it's his kingdom. And so this morning, if you're in this audience and that fourth place is where you are, and you're just wanting to know, look, Lord, just tell me. Just tell me what you want me to do. Well, maybe that means in a moment as we're singing, maybe it just means that in the quietude of your heart, you need to speak to God and ask him to forgive you some things that you know and he knows. But maybe it means that you need to be baptized today, that you need to have every sin in your life completely and totally forgiven so that you can rise to walk in newness of life. If that's you, then this invitation was designed for you, and we hope you'll let us help you. Let's stand and let's sing. There's so many good things that happen in our church family. We have so many occasions in our congregation to rejoice about amazing things that God does among us. But one of the continual sources of true and genuine Christian joy for us are our young people. I've said it a thousand times, that from our youngest young people to our college students who cast their lot with us, that we have among us some of the best and brightest, some of the most morally and ethically sensitive young people to be found anywhere. Young people who really are trying to remember their Creator in the days of their youth. Man, they are such an inspiration to us. This morning, Joseph comes before us. Josh wants to be baptized today. You know, we've watched Josh grow up in our church family. We've seen the outstanding young man that he is. He excels in so many ways, in so many different areas of his life. But spiritually, he's so committed to the Lord, and we're so grateful for that. And we're going to help him be baptized this morning.
Please turn to number 517 on our songbooks. Number 517, Heaven Came Down and Glory Filled My Soul. Heaven Came Down, and we'll also be singing Hallelujah, Praise Jehovah, and we'll stand as after we get done here. So that's number 3 if you want to mark your song books. But Heaven Came Down.
Don't be, oh, what a wonderful, wonderful day.
Oh, Josh, what a wonderful day this is. What a privilege it's been to watch you grow into the fine young man that you are. Josh, I'm going to ask you, do you believe with all of your heart that Jesus Christ is the Son of God?
Yes.
I know you do. I'm so proud of you for that confession. And on the basis of that confession, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit for the forgiveness of your sins.
In just a moment, we'll be led in a song and a prayer, and we'll be dismissed. Before we do that, just a few announcements for you. First of all, thank you so much for being here. What a wonderful thing that we got to be here for little Joshua as he was baptized into Christ. What a special day for his family and for this church family. Make sure that you're here to hug him and encourage him as he begins his walk with God. What a wonderful thing that is. Two more things that I want to mention to you. Of course, please continue to pray for Miss Sadie as she makes her transition from this life to the next. And please continue to pray for the Nerland families and the Trimble families as they welcome new babies. Remember to pray for the Horns. They're out in Arizona to adopt their precious sweet girl, Tatum Oakley Horn. So please make sure to pray for them. That adoption is not finalized yet, so please make sure you pray that that goes smoothly. And I do want to mention that Mike Harms injured his Achilles on Saturday, and so he's going to be on crutches for a while, and we're not quite sure what that's going to involve, but please make sure you keep him in prayer that he'll recover from that soon. Those are all the announcements I have. What a wonderful day it's been. Be standing. We'll have a song and a prayer and be dismissed.
Please pray with me. Our Father in heaven, we're so grateful this morning for Joshua and his great confession that he has made. We pray that we would be able to lift him up, to encourage him as he begins his walk with you, and we pray that you would watch over him as he strives to do what's right and be a good servant in your kingdom. Our Father, you are all-seeing, all-knowing, and all-powerful, and we give you all glory, honor, and praise. We are so grateful for this body of believers, this church that gathers here, and that we are always striving to be good examples of what your people should be. Even though we try our best, we sin, and we know that we are sinners, and we pray that you would forgive us when we fall short. But we know that through the sacrifice of your Son, his death, his burial, and his resurrection, that we have a hope in heaven with you. This morning we've prayed, we've sang songs of praise, we've learned from your word, and most importantly, we've remembered your Son and his sacrifice. We pray that our worship has been pleasing in your sight. It's through your Son, Jesus, that we pray. Amen.